can be a little bit difficult. That's the problem. So, yeah, we'll wait to see what happens. But yeah, ultimately, let's introduce these two. In the top right position as the Red Protoss, we do have Randy. And in the lower left, as the Blue Zerg, we do have James Eakins.
James Eakins saying he's falling in top right. You liar. You liar.
Yeah, you can do that unless your opponent's spawning there. And then you might be like, really? Really?
Nice try, though. I mean, if they would have been spawning in the other positions, that might have actually confused his opponent a little bit. Be like, what?
How?
But, of course, they know it's cross-spawns. The game told them. The unknowing... Wow, that's a 10-gate.
Yeah, this is the same build I think Randy did on game one, actually.
Yeah.
Which was
he
really
didn't go for a 10-gate in the second game. That was a normal 12 to 13-gate timing. You know, grabbing the gas behind it. I don't think he's going to be grabbing gas with this. That would be...
That'd be pretty bold. And we know he doesn't like a Mothership Core anyway, so that's fine. Not a fan of it. But I've got to point this out. The gas geysers on this map were not like this in the beta.
No, they look very Protoss-like.
They look awesome. I love them. They are the coolest gas geysers. There need to be more gas geyser designs.
Yeah, it
legit,
really adds
I would pay
variety.
For those. If they added more in, like you could change them, I would buy those. Microtransactions, Blizzard. You can get more money out of me if you do that.
Well, we've got a Protoss Vespian geyser now. Now we need a Zerg-themed and a Terran-themed one.
Yep, exactly. So anyway, Pylon Block coming down at the natural yet again by Randy. James Eakins trying to take that out. The Zealot getting a Chrono boosted. That's just the first one. Currently, though, the Pylon is allowed to complete. That's delaying the natural. The spawning pool not yet done. It's all very, very frustrating for a Zerg when this happens.
Is he going to drop the Roach Warren again? That's the way he dealt with it last time.
Yeah, it's whether he predicted coming, because currently he hadn't seen anything. He doesn't know whether it's a forge, whether it's a gateway, what?
He has no idea what's coming. Actually, he has an idea, because that Zealot ran right past his Overlord, so he knows exactly what's happening. And he's responding the exact same way he did in Game 1, Gas and Roach Warren immediately.
I think it's a good choice, though, because if you know your opponent's going Zealot heavy, they're not going to have a Cyber Core at this point anyway, you can be very, very safe. You can deal with a Zealot, especially if there's a second one following it up, which there is. And the difference on this map is it's such a long rush distance to get there.
It is. Takes a very long time, so he's going to have enough time to prepare. The Roach Run is about to finish up. The first Zealot already there, though. The second Zealot going to be joining up. Once again, going to be delaying this expansion so, so long.
It is a long delay. Unfortunately for James Eakins, until that Overlord is out, he's not going to be able to produce anything more than just two Roaches. So that's a bit of a problem for himself. He actually grabbed the second gas in order to get those two straight away. But now with the Overlord finished, he does cancel the gas and everything's looking fine. But two Zealots there, just happy to contain the Zerg at this point. And I think that's the right thing to do.
Only one Roach coming out right now. There's the second one. And Randy's Zealot count is starting to become a little bit scary. The third one is going to be joining up. And he's also getting a Forge. And if James Eakins plays too passive, there could be a cannon. And that really, really is going to be...
Yeah, if a cannon goes down, that would be very problematic. The Overlord has come in, though. Sees that the Nexus is down. And can indeed see the Forge as well. So he knows that he's under a bit of a time pressure there. The probe is still hanging around. The Queen's even coming down just to make sure that that definitely does not happen.
Yeah, James Eakins not taking any risk right now. He's got three Roaches here, two Queens, and still the Zealots are going to engage. I'm not quite sure about this. The Zerglings are going
to
be going down.
Queen.
The Queen! Focus the Queen! Collect the Queen!
Oh, that Queen is so lucky! Seriously, should go buy a lottery ticket. That Queen should have died there, didn't die, and gets to live to inject another day.
Yeah, and that Queen staying alive is going to have its impact on the mid-game. It's going to impact the creep spread, namely, because, you know, he's going to prioritize... Actually, has a third Queen out already. Wow, a lot of Queens coming out of James Eakins to deal with this. So he's going to have some insane creep spread. He's not going to have two hatches to inject for a long time. So instead, going to be using that energy in creep tumors, and that creep is going to be racing across the map.
Which is really beneficial anyway, because one, it gives you vision, two, it gives you increased movement speed. It just means you're in a really solid spot. We do have the third coming down straight away, and... taking the central expansion, which I think is better in these spawn positions than the one by the watchtower. It's just a bit too far away. So everything looking fairly okay for the time being. A second photon cannon coming down yet again by Randy. Clearly worried about a bit of counter-aggression. But James Eakins going for a different approach this time with that third.
Could just get a Mothership Core and he's going to be safe from everything that Zerg can really throw at you from two bases.
I think we should make him like... We should just put a big sticker on the Mothership Core hockey for him.
A Mothership Core would have solved all his problems. He's got the money for it, he's got 100 gas, but instead he chooses to spend it on a sentry.
which isn't really helpful in this situation. And the Cybercore actually taking quite a few shots. The roaches will be forced back, but if this was being followed up by, say, some more roaches, that Cybercore would die. We'd be, well, it'd be game one all over again.
It would be.
It'd be like deja vu.
Okay, well, I'm not too happy with the way that Randy handled that, but this time he went Stalker first and not Sentry first. I mean, in the last game he made his Sentry first and that was absolutely useless. This time around made the Stalker first and was able to scare the roaches away, keep his cybernetic score, his gateway and everything alive.
But I think that's really good because adjusting your build is the difference between a good player and a great player. If you can adjust your build through a series, you're doing really well for yourself. So that's good to see from Randy there, who's also got his robotics facility out quite a lot earlier rather than getting the additional gateways, so able to get that Immortal out a lot sooner. But likewise, Jamesykins got his third down there. The worker count actually equal at 39 apiece currently.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he is getting the Mothership Core out right now, rather late than never, really. He will be able to use that Photon Overcharge in a little bit, maybe use the recall ability in the mid-game somewhere when he wants to hit some kind of a pressure. He could go for some kind of pressure with the 4 gateways, 5 gateways, 6 in total, and the Robo that he has. He could pressure off that.
Yeah, he could. Well, the third isn't that easy to take, to be fair, because you take the one, obviously, between the natural and main, just down a little bit. But the problem with that, ultimately, is that, let's face it, it's very wide open. Zerg like open spaces, force fields are less effective. And therefore, I think going for a lot of 2-base pressure is definitely advisable. With 6 gates, 7 gates on their way, and the robotic facility, it is completely all in. The Overlord hasn't really managed to get a scout on anything. Sees the Robo, but that's it. None of the additional gateways. And that lack of information could really hurt Jamesykins.
It could. We see the... Is that the second or the third Immortal? Second Immortal is about to pop out of the Robo. He's probably going to go... Yeah, he's going to go with 2 because he's now making a War Prison, then going to go for an Observer. So it is going to be a 2 Immortal and probably a lot of sentries going to be warped in soon. A Zergling runs in here to scout and that is the cue that Randy needed. He's going to be taking out his own Forge. Didn't get +1, I don't believe. No, he didn't. So it's going to be a 0-0 upgraded army versus... Hydras with +1 in a second.
Yeah, and those Hydras with +1 are going to shred through both the Immortal and the Gateway forces. The probe placing down the proxy pylon at the bottom of the map. So just there, ready and waiting in order to get that down. And the warpins will be coming. But as we see, a lot of Hydras in production, a lot of Roaches in production, and +1 about to finish up.
Yeah, I think Jamesy should be fine here if he gets his units in the proper position. He might even have Muscular Augments finished up to go ahead and counterattack immediately after holding off this attack. The supply is relatively close, about 20 apart. Very usual for a situation like this, but there's not the usual +1 advantage for Protoss. It's actually a +1 advantage for Jamesy.
Yeah, and as we see, the Zergling starting to come forward, force that time warp very, very early on. That was a nice little move. I think it was trying to bait some force fields as well. And if he baited a couple of force fields, it would have been better. But the key thing which that did was force Randy to pull back and wait. He's now going to wait probably for the next wave of warp-ins. And that just gives more and more time for Jamesykins to get more and more units.
Mm-hmm. Jamesykins is just fine. The longer he waits, the better his position will be. He's researching +2, making more Hydras and more Roaches. And I think Randy is looking at this army and thinking, wow, that's a lot of stuff. Those few Hydras in there are going to be changing up the game quite a bit. Doing some nice scouting here, making sure that the Time Warp is not going to be that useful.
Yeah, great little microing back. 9 more Roaches just about to pop. Some force fields go down, trap a couple of units, but the Hydras stay up. And that's where the real DPS is coming from in this army. The Roaches are now just starting to pop even more in production. +2 missile attack on its way. And, well, Randy, he's going for it.
He is going for it. He catches an Immortal off guard and takes it out. And Randy is going to be going into the main base. Will he be able to get up there? Will enough Roaches be able to follow? No, they won't. Nice force field goes down. And this is getting interesting.
This is the problem because obviously the Mothership Core is in there, but it does not have anywhere near enough energy for a mass recall. That means that Randy is completely committed to this. The force field is on the ramp, but as we're seeing, drones just getting pulled, trying to get out of there. The lair is going to go down. The Hydralis Den's going to go down, and so is the Rotron. However, a massive counterattack pushing in, and this could end up in a base race.
This would have been so good if only he had enough energy for the recall. He could kill the Hive, recall, and be able to defend against the counterattack just fine, and Renny would be in a good position. But right now, he's kind of stuck in the Zerg main base, but he will be able to kill all the production facilities, and is going to cripple Jamesy's production as the counterattack is trying to do anything it can. There's not a lot of cannons here. The cannons have gone down. The sentries are out of energy. Looks like the front will be breached.
Yeah, the sentries just trying to buy some time while, of course, Randy's army goes for it. The Mothership Core is still short on energy.
Needs 10 more.
No, 25 more. 15 more, rather. Now 10 more. It is very, very close. That's all I know, is that it's not going to be too long. That mass recall could absolutely change this game. And as we're seeing, the roaches pushing in, they're trying to take out the cannons as they are warping. They managed to do so. The probe's getting taken out as well. But, well, that energy for the mass recall should be there any second. And indeed, Randy, go back to home.
It's too late. It's too late to go back home at this point. He has to make something work. He's going to lose his natural. He's going to lose his main base. Recalling right now, which is... Oh, he actually is going to go for it. Wow, is it going to work out though? Does he have enough to really defend here? He might be able to secure his main, but is he going to keep his natural safe?
Well,
no.
Nope, it's not. It's going to go down. So suddenly we're on a two-base Zerg who has no tech. Literally, he can make drones and overlords, and that is it.
Yeah, he has got nothing at all, lost everything. There's still a Zealot in the main base, and James Eakins knows he has to do some additional damage, and he's going to be trying to clean up the production facilities, the gas guys, anything that he can get.
Yeah, honestly, I think Randy would be best saved just defending this ramp, staying up there, keeping that Immortal safe. It's so close to the front there that he just does not want to get sniped out. Some good force fields going down, just buying time, the spawning pool being reproduced at the very standard 15 minutes 40 mark. But, of course, the production facility is still four gates in the main. And both players actually in a bit of a tough spot.
Four gates, that's all he has. He lost all his tech at the same time. I mean, we're talking about how James Eakins has no tech. Randy has no tech either.
Yep, this is like pretty much back to reset, except of course James Eakins has his third.
Yeah, he has his third, doesn't have his main base. There's still a Zealot there, just standing there. We'll be able to pick off the drone when it goes and expands. That Zealot has one HP, had a very lucky engagement there.
Ooh, Randy moving forward, that's a brave move.
Very
just
bold.
Using that Mothership core, because currently there's only two Hydralisks out, so it can probably, if those are focused down, do some good damage. But Randy, what's he going to do? It looks like he's just going to go and take his natural.
That's such a difficult position for him to be in. Some Zealot harassment being done with the War Prism. Are they going to be able to kill anything? No, he's not. This can be... might get a drone? No, he doesn't get the drone. Oh, so
that
close.
Is unfortunate. But, of course, we don't have the Rotoron. We rebuild. Yep, we don't have a lair, so we can't have a Hydroden. This is basically... This is a very funky game now, is the only way to say it.
There's no Cybercore either, so it's just Zealot production. There's the Cybercore now being started by Randy in his main base. He knows he's in so much trouble. He feels he has to all in to win the game. But I think the army of James Eakins is just too big. Taking a look at the army supply, 104 for James versus 61 of Randy.
Now, this is, of course, a winner's bracket game. So whoever loses this gets knocked into the loser's bracket. It's double elimination, so they're not completely out. But still, getting through the winner's bracket is obviously going to be preferential. Both these two players fighting for one of the 12 seeds into tomorrow and Sunday's grand finals for part of that £10,000 prize pool. And, well, it's pretty tense.
Is preferential actually a word?
Yeah.
Okay,
I
cool.
Think so. I think, yeah.
As the last engagement is going to be happening, and I think it's going to have the outcome that we are all expecting it to have. Nice force fields by Randy, making the best of a very bad situation, but there's just too much blue on the map. Here comes the Zerg, and going to be crushing the last remains of the Protoss army. Randy trying to expand to his Nexus natural expansion, but I think he'll realize how futile the situation is.
Yeah, two more sentries are going to go down the War Prism, saving a couple as best they can, but, well, ultimately, 44 supply to 117.
The Cybercore was rebuilt, sentries are coming out again, but I don't think he has enough punch to really defend his natural from the attack that the Zerg is launching right now. There's just so much.
He can hold it off for a couple of seconds with force fields, but that's all he's got currently.
He can delay, that's it.
Yeah, and oh, two Lings do get him. They're going to start chipping away.
This game is pretty much over, guys.
Yeah, it is, unfortunately. Unfortunately for Randy, he did really well. The aggression was good, but ultimately you're seeing a situation where it's a two-base Zerg. You can't take your natural. Pretty much mined out in the main as well.
Oh,
Randy.
Dancing his roaches and his hydras. Look at them being all cute.
BM all the way. These two are good friends, though, so it's not actually BM. It's just a bit of fun.
If James Eakins could drop mules, he would definitely drop them all over the Protoss army right now.
If Zerg could drop mules, it would be incredibly OP.
It would be. It would be funny to watch, though. Randy is struggling to hold on. He's got a lot of sentries, can probably buy himself some more time, but has no robo, has no detection, and it's probably going to be dying now.
Yep, there's a small gap there. In come all of the roaches. There is the GG. And Randy advances in.